what's good for the platform is bad for the ecosystem. In fact, I can demonstrate in 6 different ways what's good for the platform is almost always bad for the ecosystem. And so if we want to really harness this platform revolution well, if we want to benefit from the platform revolution well, and if we want to become a sustainable platform, it's important for us to not just benefit from the business model, but also figure out a model of governance that works for the benefit of the ecosystem. There are many different ways in which this is happening today. Openness, for example, is about how open a platform is. A lot of people do not like closed platforms, which is understandable. But openness today is seen as an ideological debate, whereas actually it's a business question. Today, the way companies think about openness is actually less a question of what should be open and more the question of what should be controlled. If you think of how Android came into existence, when Android started, it started as a completely open platform. Anybody could come in, do anything with Android, create their own version, and put things out. And what happened was Amazon and Samsung came in, they forked Android in different directions, and Android realized it did not have control over the ecosystem. And so Android came in and changed its openness so that it now controlled critical services like maps. Without maps, a mobile phone is useless. And it controlled the user data, and it called that Google Play. And so to gain control over the ecosystem, the platform had to get control back by closing the platform a bit further. So what's important is that a lot of platforms today, when they talk about openness, they're really looking at ways in which they can close the platform so that they can control the key critical points of ownership on the platform. The second thing, where what's good for the platform is bad for the ecosystem, is the idea of interoperability. Today, a lot of platforms work in ways that are not interoperable. A great example of that is what's happening in healthcare today. If you want to solve a patient's problem, you need to provide him everything that helps him solve the disease and to cure the disease. And no single company today has everything that is needed to cure the disease for the particular patient. And so the best way of doing healthcare would be to allow the patient to own the data, make that data interoperable across all platforms, and allow the patient to move easily from one platform to the other. But interoperability comes in the way of a platform's profit, because the fact that a platform is not interoperable is what creates lock-in for the consumer with the platform. So if my data remains with the hospital, it's in the best benefit of the hospital because I stay logged in with the hospital. When I go to a new hospital, I cannot take that data with me, and that prevents me from moving to a new hospital. So what's good for the ecosystem, interoperability, is actually bad for the platform. And that's another thing that we need to think about, especially when we try to build platforms in industries where the greater good is sometimes much more important than just the profit motive that the company has. Healthcare being a great example of that. A third thing that we need to think about carefully is the idea of manipulation. A lot of platforms have data in a way that can be used to manipulate the ecosystem. We have the famous case of Facebook and how Facebook tried a little experiment that made people sadder because they chose to show certain things that would make them sad and that helped them find out the way people would get influenced by what Facebook showed them. In a similar way, there are ways in which Uber manipulates the market not yet in a negative way, but one of the key aspects of the research was that when somebody's mobile phone, the battery of the mobile phone is dying out, those people are more likely to accept a 9 to 10 times surge in price than those who have still some battery left in their mobile phone. And that's a great data point if they really wanted to manipulate the market. So one important thing to think about is that when a platform understands so much data about the market, it gets a lot of power that can potentially be used to manipulate the market towards its own purpose as well. And that's something that, again, needs to be governed in a much more serious and specific fashion in the future. Another issue is the idea of trust. We think of trust between participants on the platform, but more importantly, it's also important to understand trust in the context of how producers on the platform trust the platform. There's a research done at Harvard Business School which lays out how Amazon keeps looking at data about different merchants selling goods on the platform, and it looks for items that are selling really well that work with Amazon's single day delivery. And very often what Amazon does is it goes ahead, acquires these production facilities, and then put starts putting out its own products on the platform, which over time edges out these merchants slowly away from the platform. So that's an example where it's very difficult for some of these merchants to trust the platform, but because of the power that the platform has, it's able to do some of these things at this point in time. One other thing is the idea of neutrality. Platforms should be neutral in a way that they do not side with certain participants and that they do not give certain participants too much power. One of the key issues that's happening out here in the EU right now is that Google is facing a whole series of lawsuits because it's seen as not being a neutral platform, where very often Google gives higher placement to its own services than to the services of competitors. For the platform to really create and to really create value in a market and to ensure that the ecosystem gets the most value, it should do it in a way that it stays neutral to all interactions that happen on the ecosystem. And the final thing that I want to talk about briefly is that platforms today can be used to solve a whole range of problems. We looked at some of the examples in the previous presentation about how the refugee crisis could be solved using platforms, how a whole range of social problems could be solved using platforms. But at this point in time, most successful platform implementations have come out of the stable of venture capital. And all these platforms, at the end of the day, are measured not on the basis of any other metric, but on the basis of return on investment. What's the amount that we've invested in the platform, and how much can we get out of it? What kind of an IPO can we take it to? And this is where the big question comes up, that yes, platforms as a business model can create a lot of value, but will we find financing schemes and will we find governance mechanisms that will ensure that platforms are actually used to solve the world's biggest problems, to solve problems where people who need resources the most are connected with the resources that they need? And that question about impact remains unanswered because today, most of the platforms that we see are still not working on that particular model. Thank you so much for listening. My goal with this was to look at the good side of how platforms are changing the world, but also caution us about the various ways in which the whole story can actually go bad over the next few years if it's not governed and regulated in the right way.